raised up what, quote, were evil kings, because there was a purpose in that.
Mm-hmm.
And when God says enough is enough, he can push them aside.
Yes, sir.
Psalm 24 and 1, the earth is the Lord's, and the fullness thereof, the world, and they that dwell therein. Now, you tell me, is there any more than that? The earth is the Lord's, and the fullness thereof, the world, and they that dwell therein. God owns a cattle on a thousand hills. Now, I don't want to get into this, but I can assure you God has more than a thousand hills.
Mm-hmm.
He's got more than a thousand cattle.
Mm-hmm.
That's a figure of speech, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So we can say, I'll try to make this as simple as I can, because I don't want to make it so complicated that you can't remember and, you know, be able to grasp hold of what the kingdom is. Let me just read through this and we'll see if we can kind of summarize it. The kingdom is the gracious action of the sovereign God of heaven by which his reign is recognized. That's the key. The kingdom is the action of a sovereign God where his reign is recognized and reverenced and is entered into by those men whom God had previously permitted to walk in their own sense of selfhood. So this is really what this is saying. The sovereignty of God does not require anyone to submit. I mean, God is God. But if you're going to be a citizen of the kingdom, you're going to have to make a choice. You're going to have to enter into. So the kingdom of God is a domain that you recognize, you reverence, and you enter into. See, Jesus said in John chapter 3, he said that unless you're born again, you can't even see
mm-hmm.
the kingdom. And if you can't see it, you're not going to enter it. In other words, if you're not born again, you do not have the capacity even to even visualize what the kingdom of God is all about, because it's a spiritual dimension. If you're not born again, you don't understand things that are of a spiritual nature. We can say the kingdom is a gathering together of all things into one in Christ. And that would be the ultimate kingdom. See, Ephesians 1 says that in the dispensation of the fullness of times, that God will bring together all things that are in heaven and all things that are in earth. And that will be the ultimate consummation of the kingdom of God. See, there are some scriptures that are pretty amazing. And, you know, one is 1 Corinthians 15, 28, I believe it is, thereabouts, where it says that he shall rule and reign, or Christ shall rule and reign. And keep in mind that Christ ruling and reigning means the anointed one. And if you're part of the body of Christ, that means that we rule and reign until every enemy is made our footstool. And then it says that the kingdom shall be delivered up to God the Father, and God will be all in all. The kingdom is reconciliation. Again, God can be sovereign, but there not be any peace, and there not be any reconciliation, but the kingdom of God is reconciliation. Now, all of this is in your manual there. And by the way, let me say this about both of the classes I teach this term. Both this class and the minister of the teacher, there's a lot of material, and we're going to try to cover as much as we can. And let me encourage you to glean more from this material than just what is brought out in class. What I bring out in class is probably what I would consider to be maybe, hopefully, what would be sufficient for you to get a grasp on what it's all about. But avail yourself to all the information, especially on the ministry of the teacher. I can tell you that that is jam-packed with so much, it'd be impossible for us to cover it in 12 lessons. The kingdom is the restitution of all things. So again, that's the ultimate kingdom. Acts 3:10, that the heavens shall receive him, speaking of Jesus, until the times of restitution of all things that have been spoken of by the prophet. The kingdom is salvation. The kingdom is regeneration and transformation. And again, don't worry about having to remember all of that. The kingdom is every man presented perfect in Christ. That's the kingdom. And as you can understand that the kingdom has to have a king, there has to be someone in authority, has to be in charge. Now, I'm going to give you an example to show you the difference in the sovereignty of God and the kingdom. I believe it was the sovereignty of God that brought communism down. I believe it was the sovereignty of God that caused the Berlin Wall to fall. But this did not bring the kingdom of God to Russia, nor to the world. See, God was ultimately in charge, but that did not bring the kingdom of God, because nothing there indicated that anyone had recognized and accepted God as a king of the kingdom. Everybody follow me here? The sovereignty of God brought down the wall, but that did not bring the kingdom to Russia. Except the Russian people be born again, born of God, born of the Spirit, they can neither see nor enter into the kingdom of God. That is a realm beyond sovereignty. So we can say it this way. God is sovereign over all of the earth, but all of the earth is not subject to him in recognizing him. The kingdom of God is where there is recognition and acceptance. Okay? We say the kingdom of God is limited to that domain where God's saving power has defeated all opposition, broken down every wall, transformed all that is contrary of God's nature, mind, and will. Would you say that there are still a ways to go in order for the kingdom of God to swallow up and to be all encompassing? Yeah, we've got a ways to go. Yeah. It doesn't make any difference what kind of crime is being committed. It makes no difference how much perversion, how much sin. God is still God. The kingdom of God is still real. And there are people who recognize that kingdom, and they recognize the rulership of God in their lives. So it's only to those who enter into this realm by faith. Oh my goodness, we're just not getting a lesson. That was a completion of lesson one. Wow. I thought we were moving along there pretty good. Didn't realize that we had
still in lesson one.
All right. Now, the whole point of this scripture, let the heaven rejoice and let the earth be glad, is to point out to us that when it's speaking about heaven rejoicing and earth being glad, it's not speaking about a physical entity. It's referring to the inhabitants of those realms who are to rejoice and be glad. In other words, when it says, let the heavens rejoice and the earth be glad, that's referring to people. Okay? Which would really mean those who are spiritual and those who are earthly. And the whole point here being is to point out that this is not necessarily referring to a physical, geographical location, but it is referring to people. Now, what do we say that had to, I'm going to keep repeating this and probably going to have some significance, but what are the four things that determine a kingdom? What's the first? Must be a domain. Must be
people.
A people.
King.
A king.
And laws.
And laws. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as in heaven. We've quoted that many times. And now, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. Now, this is in Revelation, but you remember what the announcement was concerning Jesus' birth? His name shall be called what? Emmanuel, meaning God is with us. So God has come to tabernacle with men. God has come to make his residence within men. This is also what is referred to as the new covenant. That the new covenant is that God would write the laws in our hearts, and that he would be a God unto us and we'd be his people. All the necessary elements of the kingdom of God were in Eden, meaning that Eden was the domain. Adam and Eve were the people. The Lord was the king. And the Lord's command was the law. So everything that was in Eden were the elements of the kingdom of God. The land, the people, the king, and the law. Wouldn't it be a wonderful thing? It can be. I mean, even now, do you understand that we can walk in the cool of the day and have communion with God? Yeah. And then, of course, one day God showed up and said, Adam, where are you? We've been meeting here every day. Where are you? And he said, well, I'm naked. Now, who told you that you were naked? How did you know you were naked? That was the knowledge of good and evil, right? Because he'd eaten of the tree. We could say the kingdom of God on earth. Now, if the kingdom of God on earth is to be a reflection of heaven, that's what it means, thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. So we say the kingdom of God on earth is the eternal union of heaven and earth. It is literally heaven and earth coming together. And we're right smack in the middle. Now, we in this earth are just simply the outward forms and the visible expressions of the inward reality of the kingdom of God. In other words, we as believers, as citizens of the kingdom of God, ought to be walking expressions of God. Now, have we made this point? Have we gotten this across yet? The gospel of the kingdom of God has nothing to do with dying and going to heaven. It has everything to do with the rule of God coming into this earth. Now, I'm going to tell you this. I have a hope of something beyond this life. I absolutely do, because Paul said if the only hope we have of Christ is in this life, we are all men most miserable. I have a hope. I believe that when I accepted eternal life, or when I accepted Jesus, when I accepted the life of God, I received the eternal life of God within me. And when it comes for my days on this earth to be fulfilled, I believe that that eternal life is just going to continue on, just in a different dimension, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. So the gospel of the kingdom is the declaration, not that, you know, one day we're going to fly away and we're going to go to heaven, but it is what? It is preaching the rule of God coming into this earth. That's where we experience healing, life. See, there are a lot of people that are Christian, quote Christians. They don't understand what overcoming faith is. They don't understand what it means to live in the blessings of the Lord, you know. And I, John, is Revelation 21:2. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. Now, I don't mean to burst your bubble here. And you're entitled to believe whatever you so desire to believe. But as I understand the book of Revelation, and as I understand the spirit of Revelation, that this is not talking about buildings coming down out of heaven. See, there are people who literally believe New York City is going to be coming down out of heaven. No, he said, I saw the holy city. And we can go throughout the scripture and show, you remember last term we talked about the Jerusalem that now is, mm-hmm. and the Jerusalem which is above, and that there's a difference in the natural and the spiritual. Mm-hmm. And in both cases, it's referring to people. See, the New Jerusalem is a people. I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, come down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. So this is literally the bride of Christ. And who is the bride of Christ? The church. Okay? The New Jerusalem is the body of Christ. I think we've already quoted this scripture basically. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them. They shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. Revelation 21:3. You know when the scripture speaks about on both sides of the river being the tree of life? I believe that that means in on this side of you call, whatever you call the river, I believe that we can eat of the tree of life right now. We can eat of Jesus. I mean, you know, Jesus is the fulfillment of all things. And the Bible says, taste of me, saith the Lord, and see if I'm not good. We won't elaborate on this. It just simply says that as the principles of the kingdom of God operate in our lives, that is essentially a holy city of God that's come down from God out of heaven. Because we are to be the body of Christ, is to be the extension of Christ in this earth, right? We're to be the reflection of Christ. Now, we cannot, by any stretch of imagination, we cannot give full service and full justification in this course to define what heaven is. But I'm going to try to the best of my ability to show you that heaven is more than some geographical location, and it is more than some materialistic view of mansions and all those things. You know, hey, all that stuff's going to take care of itself. If you have a heart for God, if you have a hunger and a desire for God, you're not going to be concerned whether you live in a gold mansion or not, are you? I mean, you know, just to be where Jesus is. Now, behold, the heaven and the heaven of heavens cannot contain thee. How much less this house which we have built? And this is when David was desiring to build the Lord a house. He said, what house can you build for me? Seeing that heaven is my throne and earth is my footstool, what can you build that would house God? Where can you go where God is not? There is a spiritual world. How many of you know there's a spiritual world? There's a world of the spirit. There is a spiritual world beyond the immediate grasp of the physical senses. I don't know if any of you ever saw the movie The Sixth Sense or not. Anybody recall that movie? It, you know, it's far-fetched in one sense of the word, but it really has a spiritual truth. And here's basically what The Sixth Sense was all about, is that a man had died, but he would, it's very interesting that he would, it would show a scene where he's sitting at the table with his wife, and his wife is just like, you know, he's not there. And in essence, what it really amounts to is he was there and she just couldn't see him. She could not, in her five senses, it took the sixth sense for her to realize he was there. But there was one little boy who could see him. And that could represent the spirit of revelation, you know. You remember when Elijah said, Elisha, it was Elisha. Yeah, Elisha, who said, Lord, open my servant's eyes. See, and what did he see? He saw all around them a mighty host of the Lord with heavenly spiritual chariots. So what did God do? God just pulled back the veil and caused. Elisha had already seen it. He just said, God, just let my servant see it. And so there is a dimension beyond the dimension that we understand with our five senses. We're limited. In our human existence, we are limited to hearing and smelling, touching, tasting, seeing, hearing, smelling, tasting, and feeling. Yeah. So we can say heaven is a dimension where there is a pulling back of the veil, or there is a God consciousness. It is the invisible realm of the spirit that transcends this gross material realm. Now, this is what I believe personally. I believe that right here in our midst is a heavenly world, a spiritual world, that if our spiritual eyes were open, we would literally see. You don't see it. I mean, do you sometimes, you know, when you say that you feel certain things, is you feel like somebody, have you ever felt like someone's in a room with you? I'm not meaning to be spiritual, spooky, or spooky spiritual, and I'm not meaning to be weird and far out. But the scripture speaks about in Hebrews 12, saying Hebrews 11 is all about those just saints who've already gone on, right? Mm-hmm. And Hebrews chapter 12 opens up and says, and seeing that we are encompassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses. Mm-hmm. See, in the original, there is no division of chapters and verses. Chapters and verses were added to help us to find scriptures. But chapters and verses are artificial, which means that chapter 12 is just a continuation of chapter 11. Seeing that we're encompassed about with this so great a cloud of witnesses, let us run with patience the race that is set before us. So, right here, and I've used this illustration, Billy Graham is not necessary. He's considered to be one of the great evangelists of all time, great man of God, but he's never been known as someone who speaks about spiritual things in the sense that we charismatics do, you know, sometimes we Pentecostals, charismatics, whatever you want to call it. But Billy Graham made the comment one time, it was really a statement. He said that right here in this room is an orchestra playing. Right here in this room is a political speech that is being made. Right here in this room is all kinds of things that are going on. You don't see it, you don't hear it, because you don't have the apparatus. You don't have the means in your five senses to pick up on that or to receive that. It said if you turn a radio on, see, the radio signals are all in the air. And right here in this room are radio signals. You don't see it. But if you have the proper transmitter, you can pick it up. And he also made this statement, I mean, it's been years ago, that he said, who knows but what? There's a train running through this room right now. And, you know, hey, y'all follow the, you see the what we're talking about? You say, well, how foolish. Well, is it foolish? You just don't have the apparatus to even know it. So who knows what's going on? Who knows what's going on in that realm that's beyond the visible? See, God is not near as far away as we think he is, and heaven may not be as far away as we think it is. See, there could be a whole world. You understand that? There could be a whole world that if we had our eyes open, we would see it right here in our midst.
So it's not that unusual to be sitting right here in heaven and
in heavenly places? Well, see, the scripture says we are now made to sit with him in heavenly places. Ephesians chapter 2. We are now, we who once were dead in trespasses and in sin have now been made to sit with him in heavenly places. Now. So that's speaking about what? It's speaking about a dimension of the Spirit. So we say heaven is the dimension of spirit reality, of being where God is, all that he is. What else do you want? What else could we ask for? And let me just throw this in for good measure. We're running out of time here. We're going to have to bring it to an end. But people get so upset if you would even suggest that the rapture is not going to be something they've always visualized. And if you tell somebody that, you know, the rapture, quote, as, you know, been taught, that, you know, just the saints are going to be jerked up and trains are going to crash and planes are going to crash and railroads or cars are going to be colliding, what confusion. And so if you would suggest that it maybe it's not that way, it's almost like you have, in some people's eyes, like you're a heretic. But let me just ask you this question. What do you think is going to give you any more? How much more reality are you going to know, and how much more real is heaven going to be and everything that eternity represents, whether it be by rapture or if you lay down tonight and go to sleep and wake up in the presence of God? Think about it. Are you taking anything away? No. You're not taking away any reality. You're not taking away any reality of who God is, what our inheritance is, and what heaven is all about. I see heaven as being the realm of all possibilities. The realm of all possibilities. So guess what? If you see a miracle, you're seeing something from a realm that's beyond the natural. If you see something supernatural, that means it has superseded the natural. So heaven is heaven by virtue of the fact that his presence, nature, power, wisdom, and glory make it such. Once God's dominion has been established by the Spirit in any human heart, the establishment of the kingdom of heaven is accomplished in that life. Let me say it one more time. Once God's dominion has been established by the Spirit in any human heart, the establishment of the kingdom of heaven is accomplished in that life, because that's where heaven rules. Heaven rules there. You know, there is nothing to me, there is nothing any more phenomenal. There's nothing any more rewarding. There's nothing any more powerful than to realize that we have the power of the Holy Spirit. We have the baptism of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit lives within us. That gives us access to all that God is. If that means a supernatural miracle, that is what we have access to. There's nothing any greater than the fact that you can say that God has filled us with His Spirit, that He has given us spiritual eyes to see, spiritual ears to hear, spiritual understanding. There's so much more. There's so much more. There's so much more of God than we've even begun to comprehend. I say this, that whatever measure of God that you know, whatever measure of the glory of God you've experienced, we're only just scratching the surface. And what's really sad is that oftentimes it takes a lifetime for us to come to that realization. Well, we might have a few more minutes on our tape there, but I think I'm going to stop here with the visible versus the invisible world. And this is some good stuff. It really is. And I just pray that you will just simply pray and ask God to open up your understanding. And let me just pray with you now. Father, in Jesus' name, I thank you for the reality that is in you. I thank you for the reality of your word. I thank you for the truth of God that sets us free. I pray in Jesus' name that you will give us spiritual eyes to see, spiritual ears to hear, and hearts to understand the things of the Spirit. We just thank you, Father. We thank you for the anointing of the Holy Spirit. We thank you, Lord Jesus. We give you honor. We give you praise. We give you the glory. Just reveal yourself, Father, in a very special way. Reveal yourself to every individual heart. And Father, as we begin to look into the Word of God, just cause it to open up to us and there be a revelation of the Holy Spirit. We thank you for the gift of life. Thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, God bless you. Those of you who are taking second class, take about a 10-minute break or so, and we'll come back.